My name is Michael Atkinson. I'm the executive director of the school, and as normal, today we're broadcasting, telecasting, video linking with the University of Regina, and those of you who've attended our sessions in the past know that as often as not, folks are the talk originates at the University of Regina, and we sit here and watch the video. So. It's a brave new world, and it's appropriate in some ways that we're going to hear about a brave new world, the brave new world of social media. This is the first of a short series of talks we have arranged this year on the role of the public in the context of public policy. And we thought it appropriate to start off with Kathy McNutt, who is a colleague from the University of Regina. So she flew all the way here in order to speak to her colleagues via video link. That's how much she believes in social media and media of various kinds. Kathy is an expert in e-governance, and we're super fortunate to have a person like this with us, and especially this person. Kathy has an enviable record of publications recently and is published even Kathy and I are co-authors along with a thousand other people on a book on public policy in the provinces that will be coming out later this year. She's a terrific colleague. I've worked with Kathy on a number of other projects, as have many folks in this room. So in addition to being an expert on social media, e-governance, and the things we're going to hear about today, Kathy's also a wonderful colleague. So Kathy, over to you.
So good afternoon, friends, colleagues, and guests. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Michael. I'm really honored to be the first presenter in the Johnson Sharma Graduate School of Public Policy's Public Lecture Series on Public Consultation. But before I begin, I have to give credit to a number of different individuals for their valuable inputs into what I'm going to say today. First and foremost, I want to thank the students in my Advanced Policy Analysis class. This semester, I've had the privilege of working 10 extremely talented students who have worked tirelessly on an experiential learning project on social media applications in the public sector. Their insight and enthusiasm strongly inform my own thoughts today, and I thank each and every one of them. The work on the subject can be accessed on the Johnson Sharma website under government resources if you're interested, and they've done both an e-scan and a forward-looking analysis on possible implications of social media in the public sector. Secondly, I recently reviewed an amazing book manuscript, which I draw a great deal of inspiration from. The book, written by Jeffrey Roy, one of the premier e-government scholars in North America, is titled From Machinery to Mobility, Government and Democracy in a Participatory Era. This should be out next year, and it really is a must-read for anybody that's trying to traverse the digital era from a public sector context. Well, with that said, I've been studying the web for over a decade. And indeed the subject of my PhD dissertation was the impact of the web on public policy. Now, back then, there was a great deal of discussion on e-democracy, with a number of digital democracy enthusiasts extolling the democratic potential of online engagement. Well, just as many detractors, however, denounced the notion of a new technologically inspired democratic paradigm. For the most part, the evidence weighed on the side of the detractors, as there was little to suggest the emergence of the internet and the web in particular had fundamentally changed democracy and politics. What it did do, however, was modernize a number of public sector activities, and in particular communication and transactional capacity, such as filing your income tax online, applying for a student loan, buying a fishing license, whatever. Well, it's no longer in the early days of the web. The web is evolving and improving, as technologies often do, to better serve their users. Governments can no longer simply rely on using their websites to build reputational capital and social authority. As citizens increasingly rely on their own online networks and mobile devices to manage their various relationships with friends, family, work, financial and educational institutions, and so on, the demand for government to both adopt and adapt to the Web 2.0 era will continue to grow. Now, despite my own feeling that it's incumbent on government to address these digital trends, when I was first approached to do this lecture, I hesitated, because there was a great deal of, there's a lack of best practices out there, and partially this is because of the pace of diffusion. It's been so extraordinary. Today, there is over a trillion web pages. Twitter has 500 million active users, and those are generating 340 million tweets per day and handling over 1.6 billion search queries per day. Facebook has more than 1 billion active users, with over half of those users accessing Facebook vis-a-vis mobile devices. LinkedIn has close to 116 million users, while Google Plus, hopefully some of you have heard of Google Plus, hit 10 million users in 16 days. So generally, researchers have not been able to keep pace with these trajectories. So while there's a great deal of emergent research, there's still a general lack of consensus on the possible impacts and outcomes. In the public sector context, return on investment is murky. Return on engagement is even murkier. The dearth of standardized smart practices has resulted in a lack of evidence-based performance measures. And we can top all of this off with problems associated with digital exclusion, privacy, security, and other associated policy challenges. So my talk today will likely raise more questions than provide answers, but I think it's an increasingly important conversation to have. So my lecture today, I will explore some of the key differences between first-generation and second-generation e-participation. I do not provide substantive guidelines or explicit directions on how to engage the public, but rather explore some of the potential methods being applied in the public sector in Saskatchewan and in other parts of the world. I start by providing a basic background on Web 2.0, including a discussion of the social web and the Web 2.0 ethos. Next, I talk about e-participation before turning to a discussion on some of the various engagement methods that can take advantage of social media and Web 2.0 tools. Following this, I explore some of the core challenges associated with social media, and finally, I return to the question, does social media matter? For a number of people, the definition of Web 2.0 remains fuzzy. So let's begin by talking about that. There are two key points here. First, the web in and of itself has not changed. What has changed is how people use the web. And second, that users are no longer passive recipients of information, but rather active producers of contact. As one commentator has described it, Web 1.0 was mainly the web as information source, while Web 2.0 was much more of a participatory web. So a little bit of history. The term Web 2.0 was made popular in 2004 at a conference, and this was hosted by consultants, including Tim O'Reilly. The conference, now popularly called the Web 2.0 Summit, was designed to restore confidence in an industry that had lost its way after the dot-com bust. As O'Reilly describes it, Web 2.0 doesn't have a hard boundary, but rather a gravitational core. You can visualize Web 2.0 as a set of principles and practices that ties together a veritable solar system of sites that demonstrate some or all of these principles. So the key message here is that Web 1.0, as it existed throughout the 1990s and into the early 2000s, was a prototype, and it was characterized by passive users consuming static content. As such, Web 1.0 basically functioned as a publishing medium with limited interactive capacity. Web 2.0 is fundamentally different, as users produce and share dynamic content in real time, with the platform functioning as a communication mechanism with extensive interactive capacity. So the essential difference between the two is that in the case of Web 1.0, most users were content consumers rather than content producers. A user would visit a website, consume the information provided, and that would be it. In the second generation, any user could produce content with numerous applications available to assist in the content creation process. Facebook, for example, allows users to create a personal page and share all types of content, including personal information, photos, views, music, links, and so forth. So again, it's very important, Web 2.0 does not refer to any improved technical specification of the web, but rather to the cumulative shifts in how the web is used by both software developers and individual users. As such, Web 2.0 cannot be simply treated as an improvement on web processing, but must also be understood as a type of ethos with several principal embedded assumptions. It is within this ethos that Web 2.0 finds meaning. Indeed, the most common problem with social media in the public sector context occurs when Web 2.0 tools are adopted without adopting a Web 2.0 ethos. Simply using the technologies only changes governments at the margins. So, as many of you know, ethos comes from the Greek language and means character, and is popularly used to describe the guiding values, beliefs, or ideals that define or characterize a community or nation. So it's not an ideology, but rather a set of values. Now, the jury is still out on what exactly constitutes a Web 2.0 ethos, but there's some obvious values associated with it. Participation is likely the most important value of Web 2.0, as every aspect of it is driven by participation. whatever it might be referred to as the collective intelligence of the web, was enabled by platforms that provide extremely easy content creation and sharing, such as blogs, social networking sites, and content communities. However, these platforms are only enacted if people are using them. The second value is openness. The web ethos strongly embraces the spirit of openness. In the public sector, this is most commonly referred to as open government, with a number of public sector's organizations have already embraced, in particular the United States. And the baseline premise to openness is that meaningful participation requires open, transparent access to applications, content, and information. Finally, collaboration is critical to the Web 2.0 ethos. Clay Shirky's book, Here Comes Everybody, is all about mass collaboration, and in his view, Web 2.0 depends largely on the capacity to form self-organizing groups that can outperform traditional organizations. Now, there are other characteristics, but I think participation, openness, and collaboration capture the general Web 2.0 ethos as it currently exists. Now, 2.0 has become a very popular suffix added on to various organizations and processes, including government 2.0, business 2.0, not-for-profit 2.0, citizen 2.0, and you name it, it has the Web 2.0 suffix kind of slapped onto it. Well, what do all these 2.0s hold in common is an assumption about those cumulative changes of the web use. Government 2.0 is defined in reference to Web 2.0. in that there is both the technological functional ability assigned to the term, the ability to use the technologies and instruments, in addition to the ethos just described. Public sector use of the web for delivering government information and services has typically been referred to as e-government. In the first generation of e-government, there was a focus on the automation of mainly administrative functions, with the integration of new electronic channels and the production of massive websites. In other words, it was a modernization of traditional government processes. Second generation e-government, or government 2.0, is more focused on social and political functions and public engagement. And in this context, it is more concerned with the reorganization of governing processes, including a greater embracement of participation, collaboration, and openness. Now, despite the excitement surrounding government 2.0, there remains numerous challenges to public sector implementation. Government's organizational culture is risk-averse, and without a basic set of best practices on managing risk, support for social media may be undermined by traditional administrative practices to control the message. Furthermore, there are a number of information privacy and language concerns, which are further exacerbated by many of the Westminster structures. Thus, although the popularity of social media for political purposes and the use of blogs and Twitter for providing political commentary are standardized features of the modern democratic landscape, the public sector often resists the level of collaborative capacity and public engagement supported by new digital tools. Now, one of the key components of Web 2.0 is the social web, which refers to social aspects of Web 2.0 communication and the emergence of social software, including the entire suite of social media tools. In particular, it is in this term that speaks to the sets of social relationships, including the entire suite of tools such as Facebook, YouTube. Social media are both web-based and mobile-based technologies used for social interaction. And as many of you know, there's a great deal of crossover between social media categories. Twitter is under microblogging, but it is also under social networking. And Facebook is under social networking, but it's also a massive photo sharing site. Now, there are multifaceted reasons for politicians, public sector employees, and the public to use social media tools. For example, politicians are using Twitter and Facebook to campaign and stay connected to constituents, and we've certainly seen this from Premier Wall. Social media applications are extremely popular among activists and interest groups who use digital tools to organize, communicate, and advocate preferred policy outcomes. The latest example of this in Saskatchewan was the extensive social media campaign to support the Saskatchewan film industry. On November 7th, for most of the day, Support Sask Films remained the top trended topic on Twitter, with close to 1,500 tweets viewed 3.9 million times by over 300,000 followers. On Facebook, the campaign reached an estimated 25,000 people, with about a third actively talking about the Sask film industry, so quite a reach there. Nonprofit organizations are also using social media to improve organizational effectiveness, increase community presence, serve clients, elicit donations, and market events. The Red Cross is often held up as an example of excellence here. Traditional journalism is also increasingly using and reporting on social media. And while I'm not going to discuss social media and journalism today, there is actually a panel tomorrow at the University of Regina that's being hosted by the School of Journalism, titled The Internet, the End of Journalism, Art's Future, so if any of you are interested in that. Finally, many public intellectuals and public pundits and citizen journalists host blogs or Twitter accounts. So in sum, the social media marketplace is vast, with numerous digital tools available to governments, advocacy groups, and third sector organizations. So that's somewhat of an abbreviated introduction definition of Web 2.0, the social web, and the Web 2.0 ethos. So now I would like to turn to e-participation. Public discontent with democratic practices and institutions has been a major problem in contemporary Canada. Most commentators refer to the widespread distrust in elected officials and government as a democratic deficit. Voter apathy, falling levels of civic literacy, suspicion of political leadership, and discontent with traditional modes of engagement are all symptomatic. From the 1990s onwards, there had been a great deal of enthusiasm surrounding the applied uses of new information communication technologies to consult with citizens. E-consultations, as they were originally conceptualized, were thought to facilitate more direct interactivity between governments and citizens, they were thought to promote cost efficiencies, and they were thought to improve the public's perceptions of government's responsiveness. So there was a bit of an explosion of e-consultation tools, ranging from question and answer discussion forums you might find on an organizational website, to online surveys and polls which just pop up randomly while you're surfing the web. Feedback was also commonly collected through online workbooks that were designed to supplement offline consultation processes, and there was also the emergence of e-petitions and e-panels. Now, there was nothing particularly extraordinary about these e-consultations, as the same consultative designs and processes remained in use. What expanded was the capacity to provide information to citizens and to collect feedback online using online channels. So traditionally, and by this I mean for about the last 15 years, e-consultations have been used primarily to reinforce representative democracy by enhancing the ability of government and other organizations to ask citizens or members of organizations for their opinions and feedback. However, this has largely become a politically correct procedural trend, as citizen input is too often only ambiguously integrated into the decision-making process. The result has been that much democratic discontent remains. Indeed, in 2010, only 2.5% of Canadians had actually provided an opinion in an e-consultation process. So part of the problem with these structured e-forms is that they were not always user-friendly, and in many cases, the level of civic literacy required to participate was quite high. So the question becomes, will Web 2.0 and social media stem the tide of public discontent by expanding public engagement and renewing democratic governance? Today, I'm going to suggest that the answer may lie more in ongoing public engagement than specific e-consultation processes. Public engagement, in its ideal form, comes from ideas associated with participatory democracy, which sits much more comfortably with the Web 2.0 ethos of participation, openness, and collaboration. In a participatory democracy, decision makers are forced to be accountable for their actions in systematic, continuous fashion, as opposed to every 4 years, which moves beyond simply collecting citizens' input to actually involving citizens in the decision-making process. This requires that government not only facilitate such conversations, but actually join in. Instead of inviting citizens to interact with governments in the official e-participation spaces in accordance with their rules and their structures, it is increasingly incumbent on government to go to the electronic spaces where citizens prefer to have discussions, create content, and collaborate with others. So let's consider some different types of participation and how they still fit, classic participation still fits very, very comfortably with social media tools. So one of the most often cited participation taxonomies is a 5-stage process developed by the International Association of Public Participation. This spectrum suggests there are 5 participation purposes: to inform, to consult, to involve, to collaborate, and to empower. The basic idea is that the further down the spectrum you go, the more public impact and value the public participation has. The basic idea at the lower end of the spectrum is we have inform, which means to provide the public with objective information to assist in public understanding of issues and options. Government's core commitment to the public in this context is simply to keep them informed. The second approach is to consult, which refers to a process through which public feedback on analysis, alternatives, and/or decisions is collected. The commitment here is that governments will listen. This has been a long tradition of consultation in democratic systems, particularly in Saskatchewan, Canada. The third participation process is to involve the public, and here the commitment becomes one where government promises to work with the public. The fourth type is collaboration, which refers to a process by which governments partner with the public in decision-making. The key commitment is to innovate in a collective context. Finally, at the highest end of the participation spectrum is empowerment, which refers to government implementing what the public decides. Social media can be used to support every one of these forms of public participation. So today I'm going to focus on five specific methods of engagement supported by Web 2.0, and in particular the social web, including crowdsourcing, co-creation, social networking, social voting, and wikis. As just discussed, the social web contains a range of tools that support these modes of engagement, including blogs and microblogs, social networking sites, content sharing communities, and virtual communities. So the first thing to note is that there's no ideal social media tool for participation. What matters is the intent. In other words, a social networking site such as Facebook can be used for everything from simply informing to full empowerment. What matters depends on the participation goals of the organization hosting the account or page. So the first method I'm going to discuss is crowdsourcing, which is a mode of engagement where governments outsource an activity to the citizenry or the crowd to enable widespread participation. Now the idea here is to pose a problem to the public and create an open call for input. The distributed problem-solving method invites an undefined public to engage in the hunt for a solution. This is more about reach than it is, this is more about reach, as a much larger and diverse pool of people can be accessed by crowdsourcing a problem than could be achieved through more traditional methods. Mutually beneficial value here is a collection of input. However, it also supports innovation through public engagement and enhanced government legitimacy. So let me give you an example, specifically how Iceland crowdsourced its constitution. The creation of a new Icelandic constitution emerged following a 2008 financial meltdown when three major Icelandic banks collapsed, resulting in a great deal of political turbulence, eventually forcing the resignation of the government. The crisis drew a great deal of attention to the outdated constitution, and a committee was struck to draft a new one. So as Iceland embarked on reshaping its political system, a 25-member elected constitutional council was selected. After public meetings of 900-plus people, the initial results were published online for further feedback, as were the constitutional council's meeting notes, which were also open for online commentary. As a key part of the process was inviting the general public to participate in the drafting of the new constitution through social media tools such as Twitter and Facebook. Using the 3,600 comments posted and 370 suggestions made, the council used the ideas raised through social media sites to deliver the crowdsourced constitutional draft in 2011. The draft was voted on in a referendum in October 2012 with an approval rating of 65%. And the voter turnout there was 45%. While not legally binding, the referendum results places considerable pressure on governments, as two-thirds of the voters supported the ratification of the crowdsourced constitution. So this is a real example of where crowdsourcing is used for public engagement, and there was also the adoption of a Web 2.0 ethos. The process was highly participatory, access to documents, submissions, and meetings were open, and citizens did collaborate through comments and suggestions. Still, the example fits comfortably within the classic participation spectrum because the process did promise to listen to what people had to say. In addition, it provided the necessary information to allow people to get involved and even innovate. Instead of the process being structured to one type of participation, which has classically been the case, participants could select the level of participation they wish to engage in. So the second mode of engagement I'd like to consider is co-creation. The main difference between crowdsourcing and co-creation is a level of involvement. From an organizational standpoint, the goal here is to enhance the public sector's knowledge process by involving the citizens in the creation of value and meaning. Thus, instead of governments creating services and programs for clients to consume, the relationship changes to one where the policy or service development process is opened up to support interaction and collaboration. Where crowdsourcing focuses on quantity and results in incremental change, co-creation focuses on quality and produces innovative solutions. One example of this is the Saskatchewan government's Highway Hotline Twitter account, which was launched on December 14, 2011. Now, the Highway Hotline Twitter account, which has about 3,800 followers, provides up-to-date information on road conditions in Saskatchewan. The service, and this is a direct informational provisional service, provides detailed information through four types of road condition tweets, including highways closed, reopened, travel not recommended, and travel not recommended status removed, in addition to ferry closings and openings, along with road safety tips. I had no idea there was ferries in Saskatchewan. So the engagement here is not in the delivery of the service. It's in the production of the service. Although you could suggest the service is informing people, which is still part of the participation spectrum, consider how it works. Drivers and concerned citizens provide information which is then shared with the 3,800 followers. This creates improved service outcomes as the hotline has an active community that is committed to sharing information and as a result providing more comprehensive weather tracking than previously possible. Thus, what we have here is a highly collaborative participation process where citizens and governments are working together to improve service delivery outcomes. The third type of online public engagement method I'm going to speak to is social networking. And here I'm not simply talking about social networking tools, but the act of using these tools to engage in social activity. Social networking is a very, very common activity among Canadians. In Canada, internet penetration is at roughly 71%. And Facebook penetration is at roughly 55% of the total population, which means that about 77.5% of people that are online are on Facebook as well. And I'm just giving you a Facebook stat there. I'm not talking about LinkedIn or all the other different social networking sites. So Web 2.0 technologies and social networking activities are fundamentally changing how people socialize, communicate, shop, participate in public affairs, and learn. And this is going to have consequences for society, politics, and the economy. Social networking provides opportunities for governments to connect to communities, communicate public sector messages, and listen to what people are saying about issues that may be relevant to their ministry's mandate. There is a large range of social media platforms ideally suited to engage citizens, including Facebook, LinkedIn, Second Life, YouTube, and list can go on and on. For example, the City of Boston's Hub 2 pilot project used the virtual world Second Life to engage residents in the planning of a neighborhood park. The engagement process included formal in-person workshops, and that's in Second Life, and informal drop-in hours where residents could take a virtual tour of the park and make design suggestions. They could actually change things using their avatars. Another popular use of social networking is emergency management following a natural disaster, and we've seen a great deal of this in recent years, and we've also heard a great deal of, it's been a very, very popular emergency management tool. For example, following the 2010 earthquake in Haiti, people began sharing their personal experience of the devastation through Flickr, Twitter, Facebook, blogs, and YouTube. These social networking activities led to both increased awareness and had a significant impact on the Red Cross's fundraising campaign. Maintaining a presence on the social web allows organizations to strategically engage in different conversations, purposely create buzz, and in some cases engage in corrective blogging. From a public sector context, social networking provides opportunities to hold informal conversations and respond to individual questions and concerns, building loyalty and trust over the long term. Social networking can span the participation spectrum, again depending on the organization's goals and priorities, from passive observation of social news to full engagement. The fourth type of engagement I'm discussing is social voting, which is typically used to consult or to involve. The idea is that the more likes or positive feedback a suggestion, idea, video, photograph, or whatever other content might get, the more weight that social opinion should hold in the decision-making process. For example, in 2011, the Ministry of Tourism, Parks, Culture, and Sports, Saskatchewan Wanderers Contest, used a social voting approach to hire a summer student that would travel across Saskatchewan, showcasing the province through blogs, tweets, Facebook, and other traditional media. More than 60 young people entered the contest, which included creating a video on why the entry should be the Saskatchewan Wanderer, and then promoting their video through various social media tools. Once the ministry had produced a short list of contestants, people, the public, were invited to vote on their favorite entry, with the public deciding who the top five candidates were. Thus, social voting lands very comfortably on the involvement side of the spectrum. However, different levels of participation were occurring in the case of the Saskatchewan Wanderer. Individuals that entered the contest provided content in the form of online videos, which were promoting Saskatchewan. They promoted the program to their family and friends, and then social voting was used as a collaborative filter that revealed public preferences. While these preferences were clearly taken into account, government was not obliged to hire any particular individual, but it did provide a short list. The fifth method of engagement I'm going to speak to is the wiki. Now, I'm sure all of you have heard of a wiki. A wiki is from the Hawaiian word for quick and is a type of website that can be easily edited by anyone. The most well-known wiki is the online encyclopedia Wikipedia, and wikis are large-scale, knowledge-sharing projects that seek a collective pooling of content. For example, in their pursuit to create an information-sharing environment, the United States intelligence community developed Intellipedia, a platform that hosts three wikis with different levels of classification. Used for internal collaboration by 16 key intelligence agencies, Intellipedia represents a major advancement in information sharing and network learning. Similarly, GCpedia, an internal Government of Canada wiki used for collaboration and knowledge sharing, was launched as a government-wide pilot on October 28, 2008. By 2012, there is more than 32,000 registered users coming from over 150 federal departments and agencies. As a platform, GCpedia used to publish and share minutes for meetings, used to brainstorm on new projects, or collaboratively author interministerial documents. It's also used as a knowledge management system and for a variety of other content sharing and creating purposes. In addition, it has also been shown to help shape communities of practice across government, providing collaborative opportunities throughout the regions. And thus far, it has been heralded as a very big success, breaking down information silos and producing new levels of policy capacity through information sharing and collaboration. So, despite all the promise and potential of social media and the Web 2.0 acting as tools engagement, there's also some challenges. One of the biggest challenges is the cost of democratization. And I don't think a lot of governments have actually recognized this yet, and I think it's going to become much more of a popular topic in the future. According to Thomas Breyer, public participation in decision-making incurs three types of costs. First, there's production costs. Second, there's participation costs. And third, there's democratization costs. The cost of production refers to the cost borne by government in the design and implementation of a participatory process. The cost of participation refers to the efforts of citizens to actually engage in that process. Production and participation costs have traditionally had an inverse relationship. For example, in a large-scale consultation process, governments often host public meetings in different communities, incurring all kinds of different production costs associated with facilitators, travel, venues, what lowers the participation cost quite a bit for folks in the area because it's much easier to access. Now, engaging citizens in online venues does mitigate this traditionally inverse relationship between production and participation. However, it also increases citizens' democratic expectations. The cost of democratization is thus a result of social media tools not implemented in the social, collaborative, and deliberative manner intended. Thus, when social media is used to engage citizens and solicit participation, there is an expectation that governments will incorporate the feedback into decision-making processes. If citizens' input is not valued, the cost of democratization will be high as citizens lose trust and governments lose legitimacy. Another challenge is learning how to deal with the emergence of flash activism. Flash activists who use social media to mobilize the masses and promote issue awareness. And they use an arsenal of social media tools, including Twitter, blogs, Facebooks, and increasingly mobile devices. One of the things that we've seen a lot of is that social media has radically increased the influence of free agent activists. And these are agents that are not connected to political parties or organizations, but rather connected to causes. As a result, emergence of virtual issue networks can happen very, very suddenly. And however, even though they're rarely spontaneous, they've typically been organized by a group, we are often cannot prepare for them. For example, in March 2012, a San Diego-based nonprofit group called Invisible Children released a 30-minute video called Kony 2012. The video described how Joseph Kony, a Ugandan warlord and leader of the Lord's Resistance Army, had been implicated in a myriad of war crimes against humanity, including the use of child soldiers. So the public engagement, which came through the actual organization, was just basically watch the video and share it. Through this process, the video went viral, amassing millions of views in a very short period, and this significantly increased the issue saliency in the minds of the public. In just 24 hours, it was a top trending topic on Twitter in the United States, Europe, Canada, and Australia. And even though there was backlash following the video of it, you can see where the crowd made it very popular and then brought it back down again. We can talk about that later though. And there's also been examples of flash mob activism. And this is a little bit more troublesome. This is when flash mob activism are very planned events that organize spontaneously, increasingly energized by mobile devices and social media. And we've seen this through the riots in London and some of the protests in Spain. Now, if that wasn't enough, social media does have some challenges. In addition to these new challenges, there's also new manifestations of old problems, such as privacy and security, which are major priorities in the information technology sector, with social media sites prone to various types of cyber threats. And while I'm not going to speak to privacy today, and I'm going to say that right up front, I'm not going to speak directly to privacy today, it's going to be a huge issue for government. Probably the number one policy issue associated with social media is going to be privacy. Instead, I'm going to speak to a couple other administrative trends. First is the loss of control of the message. The public sector's use of social media does imply some loss of control, which is quite frankly the opposite of how the government is used to doing business. Whether it be loss of control over the message, the audience, or the speed at which the message travels, there is a real uncomfortability with social media for many public sector organizations. Now, I would argue that this trepidation is somewhat misplaced. Government still has control over its content. In other words, it controls what is being posted on Facebook and what is being tweeted. What does not have control over, and never really has, is the public's response. The difference here is that in traditional media venues, governments did not see the response, whereas with social media, the response is quite obvious. On a positive note, this allows governments to monitor issues much more closely and respond to problems and concerns. However, in the future, governments will have to work to build their social authority with control garnered more through reputation. To do this, governments must join these conversations and engage citizens. The current tendency to use social media for purely communication and informational purposes basically demonstrates the layering of old managerial approaches onto new institutional and digital media cultures. Now, despite the promise of new digital tools, social media benefits are variable across populations. And digital exclusion is exacerbated by social exclusion. Using social media for purposes of public engagement requires both access and empowerment. In terms of access, broadband territorial coverage is a major issue, with the geographical digital divide long recognized as a major accessibility barrier. Empowerment, on the other hand, refers to e-inclusion and is concerned with people's participation in the information society, including access to digital technologies. While social media presents opportunities to promote greater participation, digital exclusion arising from existing socioeconomic and cultural barriers, low levels of civic and digital literacy are still common problems, especially among certain vulnerable populations. Finally, a great deal of work needs to be done on developing public sector social media guidelines and frameworks, some of which will eventually require legislation. Obviously, privacy is one of the major concerns, as governments are responsible for the protection of any personal information that is collected and disclosed. But then there's also records management, information security, intellectual property, internal social media usage, rules surrounding social media background checks, e-inclusion policy, and the list is going to go on and on. In addition, public sector training on social media will be required to shore up human resource capacity, as social media fluency will be a key skill in the future, and public employees will increasingly have to possess these skills. So does social media matter? The impact of Web 2.0 in social media will produce consequent implications for public administration, public policy, and public engagement. These implications are going to be cultural, organizational, legislative. They're not technical. I believe there's three major reasons why social media matters to the public sector in the Web 2.0 era: virtualization, mobility, and responsiveness. In the last decade, the virtualization of various human activities has become increasingly common, with online dating, internet shopping, e-learning, virtual communities, and virtual gaming everyday activities for many Canadians. The virtualization of government began with electronic government and predominantly featured public sector websites mediating numerous government-society interactions, particularly those concerned with information dissemination and transaction. Today, however, virtualization impacts every aspect of human life, from work to school to home. From human resource recruiting through Second Life, to public education campaigns using Facebook, to emergency management communications using Twitter, the virtualization of the relationship between government and society is expanding. As the public increasingly turns to the web for political and or advocacy purposes, social media will continue to play a significant role in public engagement and public governance. The second reason I believe social media is going to increasingly matter is because social media are mobile as well as web. And that means that governments are going to start having to operate using the mobile platform. The mobile platform offers new opportunities for the public sector to engage with citizens by either capturing their attention or by finding new ways to interact with them. Citizens no longer rely on fixed points of internet access, with various market predictions suggesting that mobile devices are going to take over personal computers within the next 10 to 15 years. The proliferation of internet phones and the provision of mobile support or web connectivity allows users to be constantly connected to their online world. For example, between 2009 and 2011, active users accessing Facebook through their mobile devices grew from 65 million to 250 million. Another interesting note that one of my students actually sent to point out to me, according to a SaskJob.ca news release in October, suggests mobile device searches had increased a whopping 266% over last year. This trend requires public sector attention, as citizens will increasingly use mobile devices for shopping, banking, and socializing, suggesting that government will have to develop sophisticated digital strategies that integrate web, social media, and mobile technologies to keep pace with emerging expectations. The third reason, and maybe the most important social media matters, is that it supports the Web 2.0 ethos of participation, openness, and collaboration, with participatory democratic exercises supplementing traditional representative democracy. In first-generation e-participation forums, governments would often create structured spaces with specific rules. Reflective of traditional democratic institutions, the processes protected centralized decision-making structures and managed conversations through a control-the-message paradigm. As a result, these first-generation e-participation practices often arbitrarily incorporated citizens' input into decision-making processes, providing little accountability in terms of outcomes. Second-generation e-participation, and especially those practices associated with Web 2.0 and social media, differ fundamentally in that governments must now go to where the conversations are by engaging citizens more proactively and preventing against participation tokenism. As a result, decision-makers must be able to demonstrate that citizen engagement is valued and impacts policy outcomes. High volume and low-level action inflate citizens' expectations, exacerbating democratic discontent. There are numerous opportunities for governments to engage the public online by tapping into collective intelligence and learning what people are saying and doing, which in turn provides governments with crucial feedback. Using social media and other Web 2.0 tools is not a fast-food approach to public engagement. The goals continue to follow a classic participation spectrum, regardless of the participation instrument used. So it is not that social media and Web 2.0 have changed participation, with informing, consulting, involving, collaborating, empowering, still able to capture the essence, both online and off. What has changed is that citizens increasingly decide the level of participation, with involvement and collaboration slowly but surely pushing informing and consulting aside. Web 2.0, the participatory web, is defined by mass collaboration and accommodated by open access. It is social, it is virtual, it's mobile, it's anytime, anywhere. Even though governments might not be engaging the public through social media tools, the public is engaging governments. Increasingly, governments will have to listen. Thank you.